number one choice for news. Fox 11, 10 o'clock news.
Good evening, I'm Christine Devine.
And I'm Tony McEwing.
A very determined car thief suspect wasn't about to let a spike strip stop him, not without a long and winding chase. Suspect tried to outrun police with rims worn down to stubs after a spike strip flattened this Range Rover's tires. The chase began in West Hollywood and ended about an hour and a half later just south of Carpinteria. Al Nipo is live in West Hollywood where it all began. Al, what happened?
Well, this was here, one of those things that has gone through for perhaps anyone here at this gas station here, actually on the outside of the pumps here. The woman just brings her Range Rover. She's getting some gas. She's going to turn and go inside. And in an instant, her Range Rover is gone.
I got out of the car. I turned around and I see my taillights moving into traffic. It was so fast.
In that instant, Robin Linsmeyer's Range Rover was gone, stolen during a brief stop at a gas station near her West Hollywood home. The young driver behind the wheel sped off, jumping on the 101 freeway, leading police on a long pursuit at speeds of up to 75 miles per hour. Robin watched it on TV.
It was too unreal. You know, I was just sitting in that car.
A car that sped along the shoulder of the 101, barely missing hitting other cars. The CHP followed close behind, waiting for the right moment to flatten the car's tires.
We were able to spike the vehicle, causing the tires to deflate.
That opportunity came in Ventura. Three of the Range Rover's tires tore off the wheels, which began to disintegrate along with the undercarriage of the car. Yet the Range Rover kept rolling on, surprising motorists and police officers, but not its owner.
The car is beautiful. It runs like you cannot. I mean, well, I can't even say like you can't believe you saw it today. It went through the most incredible circumstances, and the car barely swerved.
But with only one tire remaining, the suspect could go no further, careening into the median. The young suspect gives up, facing charges of grand theft auto and felony evasion.
And we are told that that suspect is 17 years old. His name has not been released. As for the car owner, Robin Linsmeyer, she says that she is exceptionally grateful to one good Samaritan, another fellow Range Rover driver who apparently saw what was going on, turned his vehicle around, reported to police, which were able to then gather in on the search and track this suspect. She's grateful, although all of her belongings, person ID, still in that vehicle. Reporting live from West Hollywood, I'm Al Nipo, Fox 11 News.
It is a nighttime romantic spot for hiking, but tonight the romance is gone and it has become a place to fear. Last night, two teenage couples went to Black Star Canyon on a double date when something went terribly wrong. Ed Lasko's joining us live now with that story for us tonight. Ed.
And Tony, you're right about that. It all started as a nice night out, really. Two young couples on a double date, and then it turns really ugly up in the Black Star Canyon in the mountains. It ends in a beating, kidnapping, and rape.
The end of the day in the canyons near the Cleveland National Forest, but safety concerns here are just beginning.
Well, it is scary. I mean, I've come up here for years.
Yeah, it's definitely something to be careful of. It's not something you want to mess around. I mean, you need to be careful.
Extra patrols where it happened, the scars of an attack. The suspects break up a double date. They smash into the victim's car, beat the two teenage boys senseless, and then kidnap and rape the two young girlfriends. Listen to the sounds of 911.
Sheriff's Department, what's going on?
I was driving through, this kid, 16-year-old. Kid waved me down. He looked beat up. He said that somebody beat him up and his friend and raped their girls, and they don't know where the girls are at.
Okay, I have deputies on the way now. Do you think I need to send paramedics also?
Yes, one of the kid's heads, he looks very bad, man.
Now, investigators don't have much, but they do have this, pictures as seen from the victims. Two of the five suspects, they want off the streets.
You have a 15-year-old and a 13-year-old girl savagely assaulted. It's a very cowardly act.
The teen attack suspects, take a look, take a good look. All in their late teens or early 20s, all dangerous.
They're dangerous criminals. We need to catch them.
And now back live, the two young girls are going to be okay, at least physically at this point. Investigators say yes for one of their boyfriends, the one who took the beating. He's got a fractured skull listed as critical this hour in the ICU. That's why investigators want these five suspects now. And we are live in right near the point of the attack in Orange. I'm Ed Lasko's Fox 11 News.
Bullets in a car with a missing driver, they add up to a mystery in Moore Park tonight. A security guard spotting this rental car under the 23 freeway early this morning. The engine was still running, the wipers were going, and there were bullet holes in the car and shell casings on the ground. Deputies are looking for the woman who rented that car. She is Megan Barroso. She's 20 years old, and she lives in Moore Park. If you've seen her, the Ventura County Sheriff's Department wants to hear from you.
Each day, something new surfaces in the case of missing intern Chandra Levy. Another person has come forward with information about the congressman's relationship with her, and we've got videotape taken of her just days before she disappeared.
No doubt in my mind whatsoever that they were having an affair.
Congressman Condit's former driver, Vince Flamini, is referring to the relationship between the congressman and flight attendant Anne Marie Smith. Smith told Fox News exclusively earlier this week about her one-year affair with Congressman Condit. Now Flamini has come forward to tell his story. He admits he was fired from his job with Condit last year. It says he told the FBI the truth when they questioned him.
They asked me, what do you think happened to Chandra? Did Gary kill her? I said, nah, Gary wouldn't kill her. I said, not in a million years. I says, but he would drive her to the brink of making her think that he loved her so much that she couldn't handle it.
In the past 24 hours, police spoke with Condit's wife, Carolyn. She flew to Washington with him from the family home in Sarras, California. Police aren't revealing what they heard from her, but said they wanted to know if she can confirm being with the congressman in his Washington apartment during a visit in April, just before Levy vanished. Police say they aren't interested in the congressman's alleged affairs with other women.
We're not the sex police here. We're trying to investigate a missing person.
And another new development. The Levy family's own investigators turned over a surveillance tape from a Washington 7-Eleven. They think it shows her just one day before she disappeared, buying a soda and talking to a store clerk. The clerk remembers her.
On her way out, I had a short conversation with her about her taking her flight to California.
Investigators say Condit is just one of the 100 people they've interviewed in the case. His former driver says he doesn't believe Condit would physically harm anyone.
I do not, in my heart, feel that Gary has anything to do with her disappearance, except he might have a little bit more information that might help the police.
Also tonight, the FBI is checking car rental records to see if Condit or someone on his staff rented a car the week Levy disappeared, but we don't know what connection that could have to the investigation.
Cubs in the kitchen. Imagine spotting some furry, four-legged, unwelcome visitors between you and the refrigerator. That's exactly what happened in Laverne. Jane Yamamoto is there now with that story for us tonight, Jane.
Well, Tony, we are in the foothills of the San Gabriel Mountains, and this is where the cubs were spotted. Both of them are out here, one a bit shy, the other far from camera shy. Tonight, both of them are still somewhere out here. A cub on the run, spotted from Sky Fox along a dirt road. He climbs up a huge oak tree. Animal control tried to lasso him, but the cub resists, takes the rope, goes up even higher in the tree. The cub, about a year old, eventually leaves, but his adventure has only just begun.
Come on, get, come on, get.
Fish and game move in, firing two rubber bullets to scare him.
We got him with the pepper spray and this, and he's not getting scared off.
A few hours later, the cub returns, climbs up another tree, his paws wrapped around the branches, breathing heavily, possibly tired after eating food he found in a nearby home.
He was right here, just like this. Just hang in on the pipe.
Earlier in the day, Michael Reyes came face to face with the cub after it opened one of his home windows and climbed through.
He was right here in this window, half in, half out, eating this corn.
And that's not all. The cub consumed 8 pounds of carne asada, 4 pounds of kitten food, then opened the refrigerator.
He helped himself to the dip and everything else. And
by late afternoon, the little cub decides it's time to go. Fish and Game say residents in rural areas need to take precautions.
Keeping pet food inside and all your other food locked up and out of sight, windows closed, doors closed.
Now the Fish and Game say the cubs are not dangerous, just hungry, so if the food is out, they will return. Live in Laverne, I'm Jane Yamamoto, Fox 11 News.
Quite a scare there. Thanks, Jane. The summer monsoon season hits with a vengeance, rain, humidity, and dangerous lightning. Christina Gonzalez is live in Montclair with this story. Christina.
Well, Christine, take a look at what lightning did to this Montclair furniture store. Believe it or not, this is not the worst of it. Not far from here, 37-year-old Julian Resendez got pretty close to a direct hit.
One man hit by lightning in a Rancho Cucamonga construction site.
His truck that he was working on was struck by lightning, and apparently his hand was on the truck at the time. And the lightning was transferred, you know, through the truck to him, and it threw him approximately 5 feet.
In Montclair, more lightning strikes this furniture store, burning it down to the ground.
James says, I was in my motor home. Two bolts of lightning struck down. One blew him back into the motor home, and one struck the roof over there, and instantly fire.
For it to be hitting the ground, hitting buildings, hitting, striking people, we're not accustomed to that at all.
I knew we'd find it.
Find a bit of money, all that's left. Rain coming down hard in LA County, but it was the Inland Empire that got pounded. Luckily, no one was seriously injured, not even the man hit by lightning.
Yeah, he was discharged in good, stable condition, and he's...
Lucky man, I would think.
I would think so.
This is totally unusual, and...
Hopefully over.
I don't think it's going to happen again.
And that is the question tonight, 30% chance of rain. By the way, that money that you saw being found was returned to the owners of the location here. Hopefully they'll be able to get it exchanged at the bank. I'm Christina Gonzalez, live in Montclair, Fox 11 News.
Thunderstorms roll through the Southland today, especially the inland valleys into the valleys as well. And folks, I'm telling you, we're not out of the woods yet. Right now, very mild night, 70 degrees, relative humidity 76%. The winds are coming out of the southwest at 6 miles per hour. And a forecast tonight says, that's right, variable clouds, but scattered showers continuing throughout the area with an overnight low of 66 degrees. When I come back, I'm going to let you know just how long this weird weather is going to stick around. And we'll take a look at the next 5 days as well.
Weird is right. Thanks, Greg. Well, you've seen them rev up on the Silver Stream. Now we'll take you inside the real world of illegal street racing on the streets of Los Angeles with all its thrills and its dangers.
Smile, you could be caught on tape. We'll warn you about the latest intersection to get a red light camera.
Fox 11 News is brought to you by Nissan. Driven. You're watching Fox 11, 10 o'clock news.
Prosecutors say a Newhall man systematically abused his 13 kids until two of them ended up dead. He allegedly forced them to work on the streets late into the night and beat them. Chris Blatchford has more now on the first day of the trial.
This is quite a story.
And the opening words of prosecutor Carolyn McNary laid it all out. A timeline of torture where 38-year-old Marco Barrera daily kicked and beat his 13 children with fists, electrical cords, and belts. And when 2-year-old daughter Lupita wet her pants, she was finally beaten to death.
Picks her up, shakes her till her head is floppy back, and flings her into the wall.
The body was buried in a shallow grave in the Angeles National Forest. Then months later,
he's in a coma.
5-year-old Ernesto met a similar fate at the hands of his own father.
He goes up and hits him a few times and kicks him and throws his head back into the wall, and he has Ernesto some kind of like a little seizure, and that's it.
Sheriff's deputies later catch Barrera and some of his children burying Ernesto in the forest, too.
That's how the child was discovered.
And as the prosecutor showed pictures of their battered bodies, Maria Ricardo, the dead children's aunt, wept openly. She is charged with child abuse and being an accessory after the fact.
She is psychologically paralyzed.
Defense attorney Larry Baker claims the aunt, too, had repeatedly been beaten, raped, and sodomized. Accused child killer Barrera just sat staring at the wall, never showing any outward signs of emotion. The prosecutor told jurors that Barrera was on a mission to inflict damage on his children every single day. Now, clearly, the prosecution is on their own mission to make sure that he never gets a chance to do it again. In San Fernando, Chris Blatchford, Fox 11 News.
92% of all crimes in Mexico go unsolved. That's 9 out of 10. That isn't bad enough. The crime rate in Mexico is double the world average. That's the startling conclusion to an investigation by the man in charge of fighting crime in Mexico. The report says criminal gangs operate with impunity, often with the support and involvement of police. The new administration of President Vicente Fox is vowing to crack down on criminal gangs. L.A. County Sheriff's Department investigators are asking for your help to find the killers of a Linwood man. Edgar Gonzalez was murdered in the Zacatecas restaurant last July 4th. Today, his sister asked for help finding her brother's killers.
We just want justice to my brother's death and to put it rest already.
Detectives say Gonzalez was shot in the back during a botched robbery at the restaurant. A witness helped police get composite sketches of two of the three suspects. Two men accused of robbing a fast food restaurant and sexually assaulting a female worker have been arrested. Monday night, police say the two suspects flattened the tires of the Glendale Taco Bell manager's car, so he pulled over on the way home. The suspects jumped him, drove him back to the Taco Bell, and forced him to open the register. After that, the suspect took the manager to an ATM and made him withdraw cash. Meanwhile, another robber sexually assaulted a female worker who was driving home with the manager. Police arrested one of the suspects yesterday, the other one just this morning in Los Angeles.
It's fast, it's furious, it's illegal, and the crowds love it. Street racing, where a public road becomes a drag strip, and the driving daredevils always have one eye out for the cops. Al Nipo has more.
Tires spin, engines roar, and the race is on. This amateur video captures another Saturday night in the San Fernando Valley as dozens gather to race their souped-up cars down lonely stretches of road.
Because everybody knows about the races, man. It's all good down here in the valley.
Cars inch toward the starting line, waiting for the signal. After receiving a thumbs up from both drivers, the starter flags them to race. One right after the other, they tear down public streets into the wee hours. There's exhilaration in acceleration, the draw for hundreds of racers and spectators. All this happening the same weekend a new film hit the theaters.
You're in.
Go! The thrill and clamor for speed is the basis of the street racing movie, The Fast and the Furious. Much of it was filmed in Los Angeles with locals as extras. For the past couple weeks, police have been worrying this film might send the wrong signal, encouraging dangerous and illegal racing on public streets.
It's not legal and it's not safe. The reason being is that oftentimes the drivers get so caught up in either winning the race or showing off their vehicle that they don't take into consideration the public who's driving.
Close calls happen all the time. When accidents occur, the results are often tragic and fatal. Street racing has claimed 13 lives in the past year. While police crackdowns are ongoing, they can't be everywhere.
Go, people. Move your cars out or you'll be tired.
Despite the threat of being ticketed or arrested, the racers and their admirers continue this Southland tradition. They're constantly on the lookout for cops and scatter at a moment's notice, even if it's a false alarm.
They thought the cops were coming, the cops never showed up.
Legal street-type racing in the Southland is virtually non-existent. Without a safe alternative, racers say they have no choice but to hit the streets. So they return again and again to rev and race. In Los Angeles, Al Nipo, Fox 11 News.
Nothing moved for hours after a monster pileup at the height of the morning rush. It happened in San Dimas, where the 210 freeway connects to the 10. A big rig, a van, and six other cars banged into each other. Rescue crews had to cut out some of those victims, as a matter of fact. Seven people were hurt, but none of those injuries is serious.
Don't even think about running the red light at La Brea and Rodeo unless you're showing your good side. LA's newest electronic eye is watching. Zayden Pickering tells us a photo finish will cost you some big bucks.
Next time you see this, when you blow through a red light, you may have been snagged by LA's latest red light camera. The electronic traffic cop at La Brea and Rodeo was activated by LAPD Chief Bernard Parks and local councilman Nate Holden.
Message, drive safely and save lives.
That's the key message. Especially your own.
Yet recently, red light cameras have become a hot button issue across California and the country for a couple of reasons. In San Diego, several thousand tickets were thrown out after it was found the camera manufacturer Lockheed Martin had moved speed sensors in three locations, but failed to tell the police department.
It was attributed to human error in the communication. It since has been resolved.
We've been assured we will not have that similar problem in the city of Los Angeles.
The other area of concern, the length of the yellow light, has been voiced in both Sacramento and Congress. But officials insist in LA, everyone has plenty of time to stop.
None of the intersections we currently operate in have a yellow phase of less than 3.5 seconds.
Chief Parks adds two of his own officers have been investigated for misconduct after allegedly being caught by the cameras. The LAPD makes no secret of the location of these red light cameras, this latest one, La Brea and Rodeo. So the message to those who would run red lights, you've been warned. In the Crenshaw District, Aiden Pickering, Fox 11 News.
Well, if the wet summer weather's dampening your mood, take a look at this. We'll take you where residents are coping with much worse conditions.
And if your beloved pet's been missing since last night's fireworks shows, we may know where few are hiding.
Hi, everybody. I'm Lisa Joyner. How would you like to go all the way to India, but never leave Los Angeles? I'll show you how. Coming up in Lisa's LA. I
hit the thing. Mr. and Mrs. Caruso, your son's fine.
Get ready to rock. Fox 11 takes you to the wildest summer music festival on the planet. You've got your front row seat. Tomorrow, Fox 11, 10 o'clock news. Very busy fourth for Newport Beach police, who arrested more than 100 partiers, most of them for alcohol-related offenses. Most of those arrested were allowed to sober up, then released. Despite all the arrests, no one was seriously hurt in any of the incidents or partying. For most people, the 4th was a typical holiday, but for some, it ended with a trip to the hospital. Lisa Breckenridge reports on this holiday's fireworks injuries.
Fireworks in the streets of Compton, anything but safe and sane. Set off by kids without adults anywhere in sight. This 2-year-old boy got in the line of fire and ended up with burns on his leg.
Well, we were sitting down right there. She was watching the fireworks, and suddenly it just came in her stroller.
In Long Beach, Elizabeth Gomez was horrified when her 2-year-old daughter, Caitlin, was hit and burned by a stray bottle rocket with an M80 attached. Illegal fireworks at a legal fireworks display the family was watching.
When we tried to take her out, and we grabbed her, I put out the fire on her. That's all I could do.
Had the M80 exploded in her face, she very well could have lost her sight, she could have lost her hearing, she could have been deformed for life. The individual who we don't have not identified at this point, the individual who set this firework off, probably didn't even think about that.
In Long Beach alone, 12 people were burned by fireworks and ended up at local hospitals. Another problem, house fires. This one in Montebello started by fireworks landing on the roof.
We try to stress that this is a felony. It's something we will prosecute for, and unfortunately, that message does not seem to get out clearly enough, and every year we do experience these types of fires.
No one heard of this house fire, but every 4th of July, some 18,000 Americans end up in hospitals because of fireworks celebrations gone bad. Lisa Breckenridge, Fox 11 News.
And those fireworks also affected your pets. Animal Control picked up several dozen dogs. The animals get spooked by the loud noises and do anything they can to get away. Unfortunately, that means jumping or digging their way out of your yard. Animal Control workers say if your pet vanished during the holiday, you should go to the nearest pound and keep going back for a couple of weeks to see if your pet happens to show up. Does more power have to mean more pollution? Some folks in Huntington Beach are worried about that. They see a power plant getting bigger and a beach getting dirtier, and they suspect there is a connection. John Schwada has more.
Huntington Beach's seaside charm is under attack, or so some argue.
We have a beach contamination problem. We want it solved.
City Councilman Ralph Bauer says his town's tourist livelihood and clean beaches are threatened by the state's energy crisis, more specifically by this giant power plant only a stone's throw from the beach. AES Corporation, the plant owner, is rushing to double the facility's size in time to sell electricity to power-hungry Californians this summer. And state officials, led by Governor Gray Davis, are helping the plant and others like it to get online ASAP so the state's consumers are saved from rolling blackouts. But some question if the existing AES plant's use of ocean water as a coolant is to blame for a recurring beach pollution problem. It's an issue scientists are now carefully studying.
We're looking at the power plant as a prime suspect right now, and of course there's lots of testing that's being done right now to prove yes or no.
The power plant manager says his company is committed to do the right thing.
We want to do what we do to keep the lights on, but not impact the community any more than we have to.
But Ralph Bauer and others believe when push comes to shove, Huntington Beach's shoreline may be forced to take a back seat to the state's energy crisis needs. In Huntington Beach, I'm John Schwada, Fox 11 News.
Well, the testing at Huntington Beach will go on for months to determine if, in fact, the power plant is responsible for that contamination.
If our rain just inconvenienced you today, consider yourself lucky. Could have been worse. Six people found themselves trapped when a sudden downpour flooded the roads in Las Vegas. One driver says the water level came up to car windows.
The water was so high, and I don't swim, and the current had so much force to it that there was no way I was going to be able to walk out of that car.
Firefighters and passersby worked together to get everybody out. The good news here, as bad as it looks, nobody was hurt, and that was a lot of rain coming down there in Las Vegas, and they've had flooding problems before in the past.
Well, it's beginning to be a theme. You heard it, folks. Again, more thunderstorms in the Southland today and high humidity. It's been sticky lately, and guess what? That pattern will continue at least for a little while. But toward the end of the weekend, we're going to start to clear up, dry up, and actually cool down just a little bit. But right now, still a very mild night, 69 degrees, and the humidity is going down for now. The winds are out of the southwest at 6 miles per hour. And our forecast says tonight, though, we're going to keep that stuff in there. Look at this hot and muggy weather. 84 degrees in Van Nuys right now, 69 in Santa Monica, 74 in Long Beach, and Fullerton, 77 there, Ontario, about 80 degrees. And like I said, the thunderstorms and the showers will continue tonight with variable clouds and an overnight low of 66 degrees as we make our way into tomorrow. Partly cloudy skies, and we're going to leave that 30% of rain, chance of rain in our forecast. And like I said, as we make our way into the weekend, things will start to change a little bit. But along the coast, the beaches, another warm day, 70 to about 76 degrees. The basin from the mid-70s to the low 80s, and the valleys will see temperatures in the upper 80s in some of the warmer locations. Now, big-time rain back east, and this is in North Carolina, Wake County, North Carolina. Both the Triple W Airport and nine holes of the Crooked Creek Golf Course almost underwater, and because of a series of storms that moved through the area over the last 24 hours, and the bad news is they have more storms on the way. Now, for us, our weather isn't going to be as intense. In fact, temperatures tomorrow will be in the 60s and 70s as we make our way down in the Santa Barbara area. But look at all the showers and thundershowers still in the area. Why? Because of that high-pressure system that's rotating that monsoonal moisture our way. All this is a part of that monsoonal episode that's been bringing us showers and thundershowers for the last at least week or so, and also the cause of the muggy weather. Another day of that tomorrow, and then, like I said, as we make our way into Saturday, things will start to change a little bit, and I'll tell you why. Because this is the system that's been producing all the wet stuff and the muggy weather. It's starting to move to the east a little bit. As high pressure breaks down, as the system continues to move to the east, we're going to get this onshore flow, and we're going to kind of get this thing cleared out by the weekend. Late Saturday into Sunday, we will notice a big change right here in Southern California, the end of the thunderstorms. So for tomorrow, partly cloudy skies with a downtown high of 78 degrees. There's the sunrise and sunset information. Take a look at some more temperatures in your neck of the woods for tomorrow. 88 degrees up there in Simi Valley. And things will warm up to the high 70s downtown, 78 degrees there. And San Bernardino, my kind of town, 86 degrees for tomorrow. Riverside, 85 top, even to you guys in Ontario. Here's your five-day forecast. Here is the bottom line on the next 5 days. We're actually going to cool down a little bit. And as of Sunday, we'll actually get rid of the thunderstorms. Are you kind of tired of those thunderstorms by now?
Yeah.
Are you tired of the sticky weather as well?
Yes.
Okay, it's out of here by Sunday.
We'll take your forecast.
Okay.
Thanks, Greg. Well, we'd like to show you a miracle in the making, if we could, with a little help from humans. You are looking at a rare father-daughter outing on Catalina Island, a male bald eagle and his 12-week-old female offspring almost ready to take her first flight. Now, Steve Heron of our Fox 11 news staff took these pictures yesterday. This is more proof that the program to return bald eagles to Catalina is in fact working. All the eagles on the island were wiped out, you may recall, 50 years ago by pesticide contamination.
One of the best things about living in Los Angeles is it's truly a melting pot. In tonight's Lisa's LA, Lisa Joyner takes you to Artesia's colorful neighborhood of Little India, a trip worth taking.
The god Ganesha, remover of obstacles, a prominent symbol of Indian culture and a prominent fixture all over Little India here in Artesia. It's a community celebrating all things Indian. This is Lord's Jewelers, and it was the first shop on the block.
I have never been down here. You feel like you're taken to another place.
Okay.
But what was it like when you first started out 18 years ago? What was this area like?
It was very quiet. But when I was doing it, people thought, I'm crazy. There's nobody will come here. This is America. Nobody buys 22-karat gold jewelry. And look at now, people are coming left and right from all over in America.
Walking down Pioneer Boulevard is a sensory delight. The music, aromas, and colorful clothing draw you in. Not only can you come here and experience a whole new culture, if you come here to Sahil, they will customize a traditional Indian dress. Be sure to bring an appetite. Little India is famous for its authentic Indian food and sweet shops.
First of all, the first thing you notice when you walk into the sweet shop is that it's beautiful. Is that watermelon?
It's just a watermelon design that's actually cashew, pistachio, and raisins.
Can I try one?
Sure.
I don't usually eat sugar, so.
That's not that bad.
I don't usually eat any.
Mmm. Very sweet.
Mm-hmm. Good. You try it.
From sweet treats to imported gifts, Little India is actually an American dream.
Well, it was a dream. It was a dream to bring the Indians together. And slowly, this Little India has become fabulous.
For Lisa's LA, I'm Lisa Joyner, Fox 11 News.
If you'd like to visit Little India, your best bet is to start at Pioneer Boulevard and 186th Street. Be sure to bring your walking shoes because there's lots to see. You can find out this information some more on our website at www.fox11la.com.
Looks like a fun place.
It does. Yeah. And tasty desserts there too, huh? More legal troubles mount against Six Flags Magic Mountain. Dozens of angry visitors unite against the theme park and tell you about their lawsuits.
And we'll give you a sneak peek at a thrilling and unusual new show you can watch right here on Fox 11 this summer.
And a runaway dog risks his life for a little adventure. Ooh.
The July 4th holiday didn't help Wall Street after a day off for Independence Day. The Dow tumbling, losing 91 points after another round of corporate earnings warnings. Tech stocks slid 60 points, leaving the Nasdaq hovering near the 2000 mark.
Fox 11 Weather Report brought to you by Hyundai. With the freedom of America's best warranty, the Hyundai Advantage is standard equipment.
President Bush has nominated the man he hopes will polish the FBI's tarnished image. Today, Bush introduced Robert Mueller as his choice to replace FBI Director Louis Freeh, who recently retired. Mueller is the U.S. attorney in San Francisco. The FBI has been, of course, stung by recent embarrassments, including the documents controversy that delayed Timothy McVeigh's execution. And in February, you will recall, a high-ranking FBI agent was charged with espionage.
More people are accusing Magic Mountain of racial profiling. The second lawsuit of the year was filed against the park, alleging that visitors were kept out solely because of their race.
The fact that they have metal detectors there at Magic Mountain, they have other means of keeping out people who may potentially pose a threat. The clients you see here today represent a cross-section of the type of people that have been subject to this discriminatory practice.
81 people are part of this class action suit against the park. A Magic Mountain spokesman says the allegations against the park are absurd.
It is a hot issue for parents and school administrators, the teaching of gay issues in our nation's schools. Protesters voiced their opinions today outside the annual National Education Association conference. John Dupree was there. He has the story.
It's so important to provide a place for students to be able to know the truth.
National Education Association leaders deny that protests outside their convention led them to cancel a vote on gay and lesbian education in America's schools.
Is it an important issue? The answer to that is yes.
The issue is an NEA proposal calling for classroom programs and materials that teach recognition and acceptance of gay, lesbian, and transgender lifestyles in kindergarten through 12th grade.
We have an obligation as educators to ensure that schools are safe places for every single child. And that doesn't mean just for some.
Delegates were set to debate and vote on the resolution until they got to the convention's General Assembly and found out union leadership sent it to a task force that will craft the NEA policy without input from membership.
When we come to the conventions, we come to vote yes or no. So we like to see the issues come to a vote.
One of two things should be done. Either the groups listed should be shown as being representative, not an inclusive list, or just strike all the single listing of groups. But it should have been acted on today.
Why this emphasis in every class, every subject matter, every school, at every grade level on homosexuality?
Author and broadcaster James Dobson is blasting the resolution as an attempt by gay and lesbian activists to recruit on school campuses. He said his organization, Focus on the Family,
demonstrated outside the convention to warn parents.
Parents are going to have to let it be known that their children are not going to be subjected to this.
The NEA will adopt some sort of policy on the teaching of gay and lesbian lifestyles in the classroom. Now it will happen without the vote of delegates and out of reach of the critics who say gay ed has no place in American schools. In Los Angeles, John Dupree, Fox News.
Scientists make an amazing prehistoric discovery.
We'll show you how people were living thousands of years ago in an ancient cave.
I'm Rick Garcia. Are you bored with bored? We found one that takes you back to the future. It's called an airboard, and we'll show you why next.
And here are the winning numbers in tonight's Fantasy Five drawing. 7, 27, 29, 30, 32.
The winning daily three combination is 435.
And here are the results of the Daily Derby.
I'm on my way from misery to happiness today.
A stunning discovery in France. Vivid prehistoric engravings and several human graves are found in a cave. The engravings could date back as far as 28,000 BC. Inside the cave, the engravings depicting scenes of animals and hunters take up hundreds of yards of the walls. Scientists are waiting for the results of carbon dating tests that'll tell them the exact age of those skeletons.
Pregnant women who've already had a C-section may be better off giving birth the next time by a C-section as well. A study in the New England Journal of Medicine shows an increased risk of a uterine rupture if women try to give birth the traditional way after already giving birth by C-section. The risk is even higher if labor is induced with certain drugs like prostaglandin. The study followed 20,000 women over 7 years. In some cases, the risk of uterine rupture was as much as 15 times higher after a previous C-section.
You know, the Dodgers haven't won 10 games in a row since 1993. They were going for 10 straight tonight against San Francisco. And Chan Ho Park facing Barry Bonds. Still looking for another home run. Oh, drills him right in the back of the right elbow. And Chad Kruder saying, look, I didn't ask for that pitch. I said inside, but not that far inside. The next batter, Jeff Kemp, with a drive to left field. Gary Sheffield going for the ball, and he... Yeah, well, he look at this. Get a fork. Stab that thing. Bonds scores to tie the game at one. Seventh inning, Ramon Martinez pops one up the left center field. Tom Goodwin with a great diving grab. The game was tied at two in the ninth. Rich Aurelia lines one just over Alex Cora's glove. Here comes Eric Davis. That was the difference. The Giants win 3-2. They break the Dodgers' nine-game winning streak. The Angels were in Oakland trying to snap a seven-game losing streak. Darren Erstad with a deep drive. Terrence Long chasing it, and he has... Oh, misplays it. David Eckstein scores to tie the game at one. Later in the third, Troy Glaus with a towering shot to dead center field. It is gone for a two-run homer. The Angels end the losing skid 5-2. What a year for Jennifer Capriati. You know, she won the Australian Open and the French Open. She was hoping for her Grand Slam dreams to continue at Wimbledon today. Capriati met 19-year-old Justine Henin in the semis. Capriati runs down the lob and look out. You know what's coming. She's not going to be able to handle the smash. Match point in the third set. Capriati with the forehand, and it is wide. Henin pulls off a major upset, 2-6, 6-4, and 6-2. Meantime, Venus Williams took on Lindsay Davenport in the other semi. Williams with the backhand volley. She took the first set 6-2. And then Lindsay won the second, but Venus dominated the third set. She wins 6-2, 6-7, 6-1, and will try to win her second straight Wimbledon title on Saturday. Well, they, you know, say she's the Shaq of the WNBA. Lisa Leslie with yet another double-double for the Sparks tonight. They took on Phoenix. Leslie, unstoppable. She grabbed 15 rebounds, scored 23 points. The Sparks win 73-50. They improved to 13-3 on the season. This guy, known for hitting the long ball. I mean, he hits it hard and far, sometimes too far. This is his approach on number 8 at the Western Open. Over the green. Tiger says, darn that shot. He's one over par 73. Vijay Singh for the chip on 11. Go in the hole. That's an eagle. Phil Mickelson is the first round leader. Daredevil Bubba Blackwell attempting to jump 22 cars last night at Del Mar. horrible ending. Blackwell hits the landing ramp awkwardly, slammed into the pavement. He's listed in critical condition at a local hospital, but the good news is he has regained consciousness and is able to move his fingers and toes.
Rick's Replay.
You're bored with skateboards and snowboards and surfboards? Check out the Airboard, a one-man hovercraft. An inventor came up with this prototype when his son asked him for a hovering skateboard. He came up with a vehicle that uses a 9-horsepower gas engine to float inches off the ground. Now, they say it's easy to operate. Most riders get the hang of it within a few minutes. And as you take another look, this new toy can be yours for the asking price of $25,000. You remember the movie Back to the Future? It's here. Yeah.
There you go. At a price.
Yeah.
Thanks, Rick. Well, Fox is hoping for killer ratings with a show that puts a new spin on reality. The spin is murder. Well, that's how murder in small town X begins. The murder is staged. The investigation, though, is real. 10 contestants, real people, including an ex-Marine, a medical student, a firefighter, mingle with the actors and try to figure out who done it. Kind of like a live game of Clue. Producers of MTV's The Real World came up with this show. It debuts here right on Fox 11 Tuesday, July 24th.
It appears a dog's life isn't always that leisurely after all.
A runaway dog's adventure leads to a breathtaking brush with death.
And take a look at your scores.
Unbelievable pictures of a dog dodging cars during rush hour traffic in Phoenix, Arizona. Sam, the golden Labrador, got away from home, leading police and animal control officers on a chase that lasted 2 hours. Several drivers tried to corral the dog, but he slipped away, jumped a concrete barrier, and ran across a freeway as cars whizzed by. A friend saw the drama on television and called up Sam's owner.
She actually caught me when I was on my way to work, and she says, "Your dog's on TV. I think it's Sam."
But it didn't end there. Sam got off the freeway and ran through several neighborhoods, finally too tired to keep going. Someone slipped a leash around Sam's neck, then gave him a much-needed drink of water.
Hoping for a happy ending there. Well, tomorrow night at 10:30, we investigate a huge pyramid scheme, show you some ways to avoid vacation heartbreaks, get an inside look at rescues off our coast, and go for a wild ride on two wheels. It's all part of our Fox 11 Wants to Know special report. And here's just a taste of that.
Open the door, we have a search warrant.
This, the direct result of a Fox 11 undercover investigation.
It's frustrating.
She's among hundreds of student victims of unscrupulous travel companies. Hawking school break heartbreaks.
We got ripped off.
All right, sir, if you can, I want you to swim towards the boat a little bit.
John, how bad is it?
No, not bad. It's brisk. I recommend a quick pick-me-up.
You get hooked when you get on this thing.
And on a borrowed bike, I'm off along Mulholland.
Nothing like the thrill of riding. Awesome.
Ooh, that is so fun. Well, that's Friday night at 10:30, right after the news on a Fox 11 Wants to Know special report.
You look good on that bike.
And I have fun. Join me one day. That's it for the Fox 11 10 o'clock news. The Drew Carey Show's next.
Thank you for watching. Good night. I'll see you back here in the morning.
Early, too.